I would like to welcome Liz Huge to this table in order to be able to chair the next session. Liz is the CEO, Chief Executive of Map Action, has been involved in humanitarian action in many different places, and she will take you through the next session. Very welcome, Liz, to the stage.
Well, good morning. Good morning to everybody in the auditorium, and good morning to everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everybody online. Pleasure to be here and to welcome you to this first panel session, Uncharted Territory, Mapping for Humanitarian Responses. So we've had some interesting tasters from Kenneth on the potential of data and big data. And now we're going to hear from three panelists who are each have been involved in very specific projects on the ground in how to bring spatial analysis to the problems and dilemmas of humanitarian action. So I'd like to welcome our first panelist, Sylvie de la Borderie from CART ONG. Sylvie, would you like to come to the stage?
Good morning, everyone. So I'm Sylvie. I'm part of the GIS unit since 2 years now. I would like first to thank you, the committee of the MSF Scientific Day, to offer the possibility for us to present our work we've done since 2 years now. I will present you. I want to give you an overview of what is the GIS unit in MSF Switzerland, and I will illustrate my point with the Ebola context. So what is GIS? I know that some of you do not like so much acronyms. So GIS is Geographical Information System, and it's not only mapping. When I prepare my presentation, I was asked to change the title by mapping, but GIS is more than that. GIS is database, GIS is GPS, GIS is also remote sensing, and GIS is also the guy who are using this tool, the GIS officer. So basically, geographic information system link location and database information and enable visualization of patterns, relationships, and trends. So how the GIS unit was born in MSF Switzerland. In 2012, there was a first study, a comprehensive study, who led the conclusion that in MSF, there were no base map, detail map, and no reference map, reference data for the country of operation of MSF. Then in 2013, we start to build the first strategy to build the GIS unit. And our main aim is to set the foundation of the system. It's really basic. It's to collect all the reference data and to create base mapping for operational needs. So we develop a tool. We call it the Map Center. The Map Center is really the cornerstone of our strategy. In 2014, we have the opportunity to deploy 4 and until 7 GIS officers in the field. I will talk later about that. So this is the MSF Map Center. Maybe some of you know already. So in this tool, you can access directly to detail map, health centers facilities maps, or specific operational maps. If you don't find your maps, you can also request for a map, and we will answer you. So as I said, the Map Center is really the cornerstone of our strategy. So it's in the center here. So all the cells from MSF can request a map, and it's directly sent to the GIS unit. And the GIS unit acts like a front office, and we can request specific needs to, for example, missing maps, or Vienna unit, we specialize with remote sensing. And we can also, we are here also to gather all information for you, so we can collect maps and other tools from different other humanitarian websites. And all tools and all these maps are available in the Map Center. So we were first activated for the typhoon Ayan in Philippines in 2013. We were activated to do remote support. So the first thing was to harvest all the maps existing on the web. So it was done the first night before the first departure of the expatriates. And in the second step, we were requested to create specific maps when MSF arrived in the field and when he inaugurated the area of interest. So what we learned about this first emergency activation, the very positive point is like we are very reactive and we are directly supporting the operation. But we also learned that with the lack of internet, our maps were not used in the field. It was very difficult for them to download our map, so we need to print it in the headquarters and to send it by plane with the expatriates. Yeah, that's true. Also, we didn't get any feedback from the field. We didn't receive data, so we cannot improve the map with the data collected directly in the field. So this is an example of a map we create for the Philippines. So basically, it's a detailed map where you can find all the naming, the location, the health facilities, the barangay names, etc. So the main point is that all this data exists on the web. We didn't create the data, but we create the map. And this map didn't exist before we created it. So that was super useful at headquarters for operation planning and in the field also to know just where you are. So then, we have the very good opportunity to deploy a GIS officer at the first emergency in March in 2014. So the GIS was deployed with epidemiologists. The aim is to create a binome between the epidemiologist and the GIS officer. So the GIS officer, really? Oh, I need to go fast. So what was the added value of the GIS in the field? As he was in the field, he can collect the data directly. So we create a lot of GPS band team. So you can hire some local staff, you give them a GPS, you give them a motorbike, and you send them directly to the field, and you will collect the name of the villages and all the very small settlements. So with this data, you can create all these kind of maps. So you are here like it's a density population map. You have very detailed maps. And here you have our team. So this is in Liberia with a tuk-tuk, and this is in Freetown. I need to go, yeah. And then this is the map we can produce to analyze the outbreak. So you can see here, this is the cumulative Ebola cases per community level. So if you have good information and if you have good location, you can have this kind of map. This is another type of map, so this is the quarantine needs. So each point is a quarantine house, and in blue you have the needs who are met, and in red you have the need which need to be covered. So this kind of map also is very useful to do advocacy. Oh, I pass. So GIS is also was also used in the field to support the data management. So how to work with geographical data. So we were there to improve also the line lists, including the geographical column. And also our GIS officer in the field had a lot of interaction with government, so we provide training with other NGOs, with other GIS actors in the field and in remotely. And the benefit of our work was like we put our data, our reference data, we put it online, so now it's on OpenStreetMap. Maybe Pete will talk about that. And you can see here a map used for coordination. So in conclusion of this success pilot in Ebola context, we improve the GIS culture within MSF. More and more people know that we exist and we create the need, but there is a need actually. The position of the GIS officer in the field is really transversal. First, it was there for the epidemiologist, but it was useful also for the logistician and also for the coordination. And it became a bit like the information manager or the information resource person. What next for the GIS in MSF? So now we are building the new strategy for the coming years. We need to reinforce the GIS unit. We need to be ready to deploy very fast a new GIS officer. We also want to develop the training and the capacity building inside MSF. And we would like to work in an intersectional level. All these things is to improve the support to MSF operation. Okay, thank you for your attention. If you want to have the website of the Map Center because it's password protected, just come to me.
Thank you very much, Sylvie. Fascinating introduction to the GIS unit for MSF. We've just got time probably for one or two brief technical questions, and then we'll come to discussion later. The gentleman with his hand up in the middle.
Thanks for showing us really nice maps. What I noticed is that they're all quite high-level maps, and they're very useful for sort of an overview of the situation. But sometimes what's missing in the field is very high-resolution maps of very detailed areas, which are not available online, which the only people that hold these maps are either the army or the government, and they're not public domain. And I'm just wondering whether you've got any experience of cooperating with these institutions to sort of map out very detailed areas for specific interventions, for example.
So far, we are using remote sensing. For example, we map Mikaman camp in South Sudan with the remote sensing image. We are not collaborating directly with the military, but for example, in Liberia, they give to all the community all the very detailed settlement database. And also online, you can find a lot of military maps available. It's a bit old. It's from Russia. But you can find a lot of data online.
Thank you very much, Sylvie. I'm sure there are more questions, but we'll come to those probably towards the end. So okay. Thank you very much indeed.